Yo, 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 what's up? Puff. What's up, big homie? I'm just trying to set up another stream, yeah. I'm about to go live on Facebook at the same time. Kill two birds with one stone real quick. God dang. Let's see. see how good this Wi-Fi is, yo. I swear. So I got the PS4 up here running. My girl, she downstairs on her PS4. I got the laptop, the tablet, my phone. I'm pretty sure her phone is connected to the Wi-Fi. I don't know if her computer and her tablet is linked up right now. Then the desktop, then the printer. Oh my God, bro. That's why I like to just keep my PlayStation hardwired, because there's like 10 devices in this motherfucker, man. All right, let's see if we can go live on Facebook. Yo, as soon as I go live, I get a phone call. My man Juice Lip. Juice Lip, what's up, bro? You already know. You already know it. You already know it. Shit. Damn. Hey, bro. As soon as you get yourself settled in, hey, hit me up, bro. I gotta get on today. My last night, too, man. I gotta go back to work in the morning. I'm definitely gonna, huh? All right, that's what it is. All right, yes, sir. No, I'm not sure if that stopped my Facebook live stream. I'm almost certain it probably did, but let's see. Am I still alive? Oh shit. It didn't stop the stream. I guess we still in there. So YouTube, I'd like to introduce you to Facebook. Facebook, I'd like to introduce you to YouTube. Just so y'all don't feel awkward around each other. Alright. Everybody know each other now. We all good. All the Facebook people, all the YouTube people. You know what I'm saying? Just because we different, that don't mean we can't get along. You feel me? You know what I'm saying? Everybody different, but we can still get along. Right? Let's get something to listen to.
Now, I'm going to presume, seeing as there's not a clicker here waiting for me, that someone's going to press next slide every time I talk about it. Yeah? Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, the subject of the talk today being Black History as the Lost Pages of Human History. Actually, the quote itself comes from the great Pan-Africanist historian, Dr. John Hemmett Clark, who spoke about Black History in this way and looked at the way in which the history of people of African descent and of Africa itself had to be functionally distorted to justify transatlantic slavery and colonialism in a way that we kind of can't fully comprehend or understand today. If we think about a time just over 100 years ago when African human beings were literally kept in zoos in London, in New York, in Paris, that gives us a sense of the strength of colonial propaganda and how deeply it had taken root in this society and others, to the point that it was actually argued by hard science, by people who considered themselves serious academics, that black people were more closely related to monkeys.
Just trying to get everybody the best view in the house. You know what I'm saying? Everybody trying to get everybody the ringside seats.
For profitable foreign policy, so is the case in the past. I think a lot of the time we're led to believe that people actually believe the propaganda of the time, those scholars we're talking about.
All right, for my
just as we can see today,
for my hardcore art homies, I did actually mix a little concoction myself. This is a regular pre-mixed jar of medium, but this was empty. So after this jar ran out, I mixed several different things together. I mixed some standing oil or stand oil. And you can see, like, it's really thick, like honey. Like, it's real thick, you know. And I have some dryer. And some solvent. And so what I was trying to do is get a thicker consistency. And see, this is just a regular pre-mixed medium right here. Essentially, this is what I've been using since I started using painting mediums. And I have a ton of this stuff. Yo, I use it, a good bit. So I have like a really big jar. I keep a bunch of these little jars around. Because it really helps when you want to get fine details, and but it also increases the drying time, because it adds more of that oil to your paint, which takes it longer to harden. And so that's one of the main downsides that I really don't like about this product, or just by adding a medium to your paints. And plus, they don't actually tell you, the proportions this is mixed in. So I got the stand oil because it's thicker, and I want a more heavy, thicker consistency to my medium. But I wanted it to dry faster, so I figured mixing some dryer and some stand oil together. But the stand oil has a really, really high sheen to it, and so that's where I figured to put in some solvent to try to cut down the sheen a little bit from the high gloss of the stand oil. And with the combination of the dryer in it, and see how this works. And so I took those three and mixed them together in this one empty bottle that I had, and came up with this. And it's working pretty good. I like it so far. I wish I would have paid more attention to how much the proportions I mix, but I would just like a little bit more of this, a little bit more of that. But I'll try it again. The next time I mix a medium myself, I'll definitely try to get my proportions or ratios, more exact, so I can continue to make the same consistency medium with the same desired results each time. So you have to have a recipe for it, because chocolate chip cookies are only chocolate chip cookies if you put chocolate chips in them and not raisins, because then they'll be raisin chocolate chip cookies, and that's not what you're looking for. All right, so put this stuff back. My little cabinet is running out of space. Crap. All right. And so I'm still currently working on a couple of projects. I have one I have this commission that I'm working on. You know what? I could probably. I could. I don't want to rush that too much. I could probably work on a small bit of it, but really just a small portion. Because everything on that canvas is so wet right now. I think I better let it dry for another day before I keep messing with it and wind up effing it up. You know? You don't want to eff it up. All right. So, the photo for this one. Dang YouTube. I think Facebook got a better screen angle than you guys got. Mike. Yeah, I think Facebook definitely has a better angle. Don't know. I could probably, let's see. What if I, uh-oh, I'm about to rig it up. Oh, snap. Think I'm on to something, guys. Well, essentially, you guys have the same view now, I would say, more or less. You more or less have the same view. Because the two cameras are sitting on top of each other now. So I have the PlayStation camera sitting atop the iPhone. Of course I don't like how this keeps turning. Shit. But of course, the PlayStation camera has a wider view on it. Yo, thanks, Mr. Wolf. Do you work on Wall Street? Just asking questions here, you know? All right. I think it's gonna be something like that. What was I gonna listen to? Oh, yeah.
We have more knowledge about what's going on in some country in Africa or Asia that we might be preparing to go to war with. So did they know more back than we're led to believe. There was no magical time when people who really had knowledge about the world didn't know what was really going on the ground. History was distorted deliberately in particular ways, and that legacy is still with us in many ways. To the point that. And for someone like me, who I'd like to feel, and lots of my followers are socially engaged, know about the world. When I post pictures, I was in Zimbabwe a couple of weeks ago, this just gives you an example. When I post pictures of the capital city of Zimbabwe, Harare, and the skyscrapers and nice hotels, and the beautiful jacaranda trees, if you've ever been to Harare, you'll know this. Nice restaurants, people are like, wow, they've got skyscrapers in Africa. I don't know if people think people in Africa still live in mud huts. I don't know if people believe, as you're going to see over the next half an hour, there was ever a time when everyone in Africa lived in mud huts. But the strength of propaganda. Even the people of African origin are still with us to that point that we have this thing called Black History. Now, for those who don't know, the idea for Black History Month was invented or came up with by an African-American scholar called Carter G. Woodson. He wrote a book called The Miseducation of the Negro, which looked at the way in which African Americans had to be functionally miseducated for transatlantic slavery and then the subsequent Jim Crow apartheid to function in America. But I would take what Woodson was saying, although I agree with him one step further, and I would say that for racism to function in human society, full stop, everyone has to be functionally miseducated about the human story. And no part of the human story, in my view, has been more distorted than the history of the African continent. I'm going to try and share...
All right, I'm just grabbing some brushes, guys.
Tens of thousands
just grabbing up some brushes.
Very quickly, some of the snapshots of what we should be teaching. Because if we're not careful, what happens is Black History Month comes around, and we do exactly what it was not supposed to be intended to do. We subtly reinforce the idea, which was argued by serious historians at one point, that Africa has no history, by teaching transatlantic slavery and Martin Luther King. And with the greatest of respect to Dr. King, brave and courageous as he was, I'm fairly sure if he was alive today, he would go spare at the idea that he was the sum total of Black people's contribution to the human story. So it's important that we look at what we should be teaching during this month to correct some of these misconceptions, because people cannot be blamed for their ignorance if they are genuinely ignorant. People can be blamed if they've had a different set of information and still choose to remain ignorant. So can I go on to the first slide, please? This is where I've chosen to start the story. We could have started the story, anthropologists are still telling us, that the oldest human remains ever found are in Africa, that we are all common ancestors of the Ethiopian Australopithecus called Lucy or Dinkwinesh. But I've chosen to start the story here.
All right,
for those
one
who don't
thing.
Know, the Sahara is not always a desert. So it expands and contracted my basic geological understanding. As the rains migrated south, the Sahara expanded. When those tropical rains migrate back north, the Sahara contracts. Over thousands of years, this process goes. So across the Sahara, all across North Africa, we find some of the oldest cave art in human history. Pictures like this, all across North Africa. Next slide, please. We also find many, many examples of this. This is an astronomical observatory. In this case, arguably the oldest astronomical observatory in the history of humanity. Scholars believe somewhere between 7,000 and 9,000 BC. So possibly as old as 11,000 years ago, two American physicists called Thomas Brophy and Robert Bouval wrote a fantastic book called Black Genesis, looking at the relationship between this astronomical observatory and the evolution of the ancient Egyptian religion and subsequent civilization. Next slide, please. Which brings us on to the first point of contention in ancient African history. Can you see here, for anyone who didn't see this film, and I didn't see this film, I'm not in the habit of watching propaganda, that Hollywood is trying to convince us that in ancient Northeast Africa, Anglo-Saxons were the ruling elite. People that look like Christian Bale. Now, for anyone who saw the film, which I didn't, people told me, in this film, all the slaves and the servants were black. Now, for anyone who understands the way film and TV works, that doesn't happen by accident. There's a thing called a casting agent, and a casting agent decides who's gonna get what roles. So some casting agent said, the ruling elite in ancient Egypt are all gonna be white, and the slaves and the servants are all gonna be black. We're gonna project apartheid South Africa back 5,000 years into North African history. How accurate is this picture of ancient Egypt? Let's see. Next slide, please. Follow a little more. National Geographic channel. This image here of King Tut. I don't know why we need a scientific reconstruction of King Tut. We have copious amounts of carvings and paintings of King Tut from his actual life, but apparently this is a French reconstruction based on his skull. This is apparently what King Tut looked like. We're going to see how inaccurate it is in a minute. On the other cover, this was an article that came out a couple of years ago called Black Pharaohs, Conquerors of Ancient Egypt. And essentially what the article said, which is the revised new propagandistic position in relation to ancient Northeast Africa, aka ancient Egypt, that Black Pharaohs came into ancient Egypt right at the end of the civilization in the 25th dynasty, and they conquered Egypt, and because of racism, no one's ever told their story till now. But guess what? We're here to tell you that in the 25th dynasty, 3,000 years after the founding of ancient Egypt, black people finally got involved in the game. And the only people that believe different are crazy Afrocentric black people trying to make themselves feel better. This is almost exactly what the article says, even though I'm, of course, being sarcastic. Let's again see how accurate that is. Next slide, please. Now, this is the British reconstruction of Tutankhamun, based on the same skull. Can you see that if the French and the British were both using scientific techniques, how come the British scientists came up with this, and the French ones came up with one that looks French? Next slide, please. But again, there's no need. This is Tutankhamun in his own life. We've got to make up our mind. Was he jet black or was he red? Now, if you know much about ancient Egyptian art, or even ancient Nubian art, you will know that red was a symbolic color. I don't know what it meant, and we don't know what it meant, but all throughout ancient Northeast African history, even among the Igbos in Nigeria, you find in their art men painted red, women painted yellow. I've seen this in Nubian temples. No one's arguing that that meant the Nubians were red. Of course, there are Africans, like Somalians and Eritreans, that have a dark red complexion. They're just as African as anyone from Nigeria. But Tutankhamun clearly couldn't have been both red and black. So we need to figure out which one he was. Next slide, please. Now, no one disputes these invasions, okay? When we talk about who the ancient Egyptians were, there's consensus that Egypt has been invaded over half a dozen times. I haven't even included in this list the Ottoman invasion, I haven't included the French or the British invasion, that all came after this. But the Arab invasion in the 7th century of the Common Era, then the Vandals, which is where the word vandalism came from, because they was a bit mad, to use the technical term. That came in the 5th century, they are Germanic, German people. Then the whole of North Africa, not just Egypt, was a Roman province. Before that, Greek, before that, Persian in 525 BC. At the most conservative estimate, ancient Egyptian history, pharaonic kingship, begins in 3100 BC. I say most conservative because I don't actually agree with that chronology, because my teacher, Robin Walker, big shout out to OG, taught me that there's reasons to disagree with that chronology. But nonetheless, if we go with the most conservative estimate, can we see that the Persians still got to Egypt 2,500 years after the founding of ancient Egyptian kingship? So who was living in northeast Africa prior to all of these invasions from people that are not from Africa? Well, let's see. The ancient Greeks saw the ancient Egyptians for themselves. They were in Egypt during the Persian invasion, and of course, then when they ruled Egypt for a little while, let's see what some of them had to say. Next slide, please. Theodorus of Sicily. General Histories, Book 3, 30 BC. Now the Ethiopians, for those who don't know, Ethiopian literally means of the burnt face. It wasn't an insulting term, it was a generic term for black person, yeah? Back in the day, and it referred to generally all of Africa, and even the Greeks used it to refer to parts of India. If you go to India today, in southern India, you'll find people, some people, as black as any people in Africa. So it shouldn't surprise you if that term was used, but it's a generic term meaning black. Now the Ethiopians, as historians relate, were the first of all men. The proofs of this statement, they say, are manifest. They also say the Egyptians are colonists sent out by the Ethiopians. Now can you see, we're told modern science discovered that Africans were the first people on the planet. But here is an ancient Greek historian saying that Africans were already saying we were the first people on the planet in 30 BC. Herodotus, the father of history. There can be no doubt but that the Colchians are an Egyptian race. Before I heard any mention of the fact from others, I remarked it myself. My own conjectures were founded on the fact that they are black-skinned and have woolly hair, Afro. Yeah? The Colchians, by the way, are a group of people in southern Russia at the time. A whole host of other Greek scholars, including Aristotle, and there's loads more I could have put, seem very unconfused about the ancient Egyptians' ethnicity. We can't have it both ways. Either the ancient Greeks were one of the most intelligent, civilized people ever, or they were so stupid they couldn't recognize the colors of people they saw with their own eyes. But we can't have it both ways, you see? Next slide. Now, here are some Egyptologists. It's important for us to understand the way early Egyptology evolved. When the French came to Egypt and colonized Egypt, it was in the height of transatlantic slavery, late 1700s, Napoleonic expedition to Egypt. The Sphinx, the pyramids, all of these things are newly rediscovered. And immediately, the French are like, uh-oh, we've got a bit of a problem here, because we have an economy based on the pseudo-scientific idea of racism, based on the idea that some races, namely the white race, an invention, is superior to other races, particularly the black. And the discovery of an ancient African civilization, thousands of years before there was anything of comparable stature in France or England, not an insult, just a fact of history, created some problems. Now, some scholars immediately reacted to this by saying, okay, well, clearly racism's nonsense. Hooray, we can do away with such a stupid idea. Of course, foreign policy realized this wasn't terribly convenient if your economy depends on racialized slavery. So even though some honest scholars came out and told the truth, many scholars went against this, and you're going to see how ridiculous some of the explanations got. So C.F. Bonley, a man who wrote a fantastic book called The Ruins of Empires, had the following to say. He made many other comments, direct comments, about the ethnicity of the ancient Egyptians. This is one particular comment, one of my favorite. He said, "There are a people now forgotten, discovered, while others were yet barbarians, the elements of the arts and sciences, a race of men, not, of course, like most sexist men," he used men, but he meant all humans, because we just normalize that kind of language, men to represent all of humanity, "now rejected from society for their sable skin and frizzled hair, founded on the study of the laws of nature, those civil and religious systems which still govern the universe." Champollion, not the main Champollion, but the brother of Francois Champollion, had the following to say. I'm not going to read it all, but if you look closely, He says that Vonnie's basically chatting rubbish. There's no way the ancient Egyptians could have been black. But let's get to the end, and this is how funny it is. Listen to this part. Vonnie invokes that of Herodotus, who recalls that the Colchians had black skin and woolly hair. Yet these two physical qualities, black skin and afro hair, do not suffice to characterize the Negro race, and Vonnie's conclusion as to the Negro origin of the Egyptians is evidently forced and inadmissible. Now, he didn't offer any evidence. All he said was having black skin and woolly hair doesn't make you black. And if we go back into the racial science of the day, you will understand that it was actually argued by otherwise intelligent people that there were two races of black people. There were Negroes and there were Hamites. Hamites were any Africans that didn't look absolutely stereotypically what we think of West African people to supposedly look like. Anyone that has a slightly thin nose or any kind of straight hair or any features randomly that we decide was a Hamite. And Hamites were responsible for all of the civilization in Africa, and they descended from Europeans. Negroes, on the other hand, they were the real black people. And even when we find evidence of Negroes, we'll just say they were Hamites, as you have here. This is how silly and how ridiculous ideas, pseudo-scientific ideas like race, make otherwise intelligent people behave. Next slide, please. Again, two early Egyptologists saying very much the same thing. Egyptian civilization is not Asiatic, but African in origin. Of Negro origin, however paradoxical this may seem, we are not accustomed, in fact, to endow the black or related races with too much intelligence. So Professor Abiy Amelou straight away hit on what the issue was. François Champillion, the founding father of Egyptology, the man who decoded the Rosetta Stone, what did he have to say? Because apparently, according to National Geographic, the only people that think the ancient Egyptians were black were crazy Afrocentric black people. But let's see. The Egyptians belonged to a race quite similar to the Kenuas, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, or Barbarous, present inhabitants of Nubia, Sudan. In the present Copts of Egypt, we do not find any of the characteristic features of the ancient Egyptian population. The Copts are the result of crossbreeding. Seems normal when a country gets invaded, there's interbreeding. The people that live in America today are not representative of the ancient indigenous Americans for the most part. Even though those people still live there, the average citizen of New York does not look like the average American 500 years ago. With all the nations that successively dominated Egypt, i.e. the Greeks and Romans, it is wrong to seek in them the principal features of the old race. And I could go on ad infinitum of Egyptologist after Egyptologist, who, even if they felt compelled to racially abuse the ancient Egyptians, which many of them did, some of the art historians talk about, how can you ever say their carvings are nice when they're so obviously Negro? Many of them, scores of them, are like, well, obviously they were black, that's why they were uncivilized. So Egyptologists were presented with this real problem. Either ancient Egypt was civilized and European, or uncivilized and African. And very few of them acknowledged that it was both highly civilized, highly technically advanced, and also African, but a few of them did.
What up?
Next slide, please. This is the first pharaoh of ancient Egypt, the man who united the two lands. He came from what we call Upper Egypt. Now, to understand Upper Egypt is Lower Egypt to us. Upper Egypt is the portion of Egypt closest to Sudan, not closest to the Mediterranean. And the early kings of Egypt came from this region of Egypt. This is Narmer Menes carrying that stereotypical Negro face that we were told in old pseudoscience made a person inherently inferior. Next slide, please. 2,000 years later, in the tomb of Ramesses II, is this. This is reproduced by two European Egyptologists whose names are at the bottom. And this is what we call today the portrait of the races. This is how the ancient Egyptians in 1200 BC, so 2,000 years later than the founding of their kingdom, saw the different groups of the world. According to the hieroglyphics, figure A is the ancient Egyptians as they saw themselves. Can you see? It goes right along with what the early Egyptologists thought. It goes right along with what the ancient Greeks thought. No one needs to be confused about what they look like. And in fact, it looks a lot like the picture of Tutankhamun we just saw. So that's how they saw themselves. They didn't seem to be particularly confused about their ethnicity. Figure B is Indo-European people. Figure C is other blacks of Africa, presumably the Nubians, who were the main people that the ancient Egyptians had as rivals. I don't want to give you the impression that there was this magical time in black African history where all black people just got along and bogled and sang kumbaya together. That isn't how things go in real history, right? Because what some pseudo-Egyptologists have tried to do is said, but the Egyptians fought the Nubians, so they couldn't have been black. Okay, so what, all black people have just always got along then, apparently. Okay. Figure D is Semitic people, people in the Middle East. Now, can you see that the only difference between figure A and figure C is one of swagger? Figure A has three stripes and figure C has two. Other than that, they're exactly the same. Next slide, please. Now, what you'll notice a lot with ancient Egyptian carvings, and I don't believe it's quite ever got to the bottom of who was behind this all. But we have to understand this in context. The Sphinx has no nose on it, and the Sphinx has a very stereotypical Negro face. We have to understand the level of hatred that was being dealt with when early Egyptology evolved, and we start seeing all these granite statues that are otherwise perfect. Now, granite is a very tough substance, but their noses are just missing, and no one wants to explain why the noses went missing. But viewed in the context of the time and the offense that the idea that Negroes could have created such a magnificent ancient civilization would have caused, it seems fairly clear where some of this malicious behavior could have easily come from. Next slide, please. We just see loads of ancient Egyptian statues, they just ran into the wall and their nose just came off. Next slide, please. Can you see a lot of my Rasta brethren think that Rastas invented dreadlocks? Here is a gentleman clearly with dreadlocks a few thousand years before the common era. Next slide, please. More noses missing. Next slide, please. More noses missing. Next slide. Thankfully, not all of the noses are missing. These are some heads from Tanite. Can you see? More dreadlocks. These are not the ones that often get displayed in museums. Often what's displayed in museums can be the most, or what is perceived to be the most European-looking ancient Egyptian carving. So you'll see Nefertiti everywhere. But we know Nefertiti's dad wasn't African. It's not surprising that Nefertiti was light-skinned and she looked a certain way. If you don't know that history, someone's going to say to you, this is Nefertiti. She's representative of what all the ancient Egyptians look like. Can you see how you'd be confused? Next slide, please. And of course, let me be clear, that's not me saying the ancient Egyptian population was in no way mixed. That would also be ridiculous. Ancient Egypt was a mega civilization. Like any civilization, it would have attracted immigration, it attracted invasions several times in its history. I'm not saying every single ancient Egyptian had totally jet black skin, because there's no way for me to know that. What I'm saying is, they definitely didn't look like Christian Bale. This is the Pharaoh Djoser. Next slide, please. This is the Pharaoh Khufu. This is the gentleman for whom the Great Pyramid was commissioned. Again, just look at his face for yourself. Make your own decision on what you think he's likely to have looked like based on the evidence of people that carved him in his own time. Next slide, please. And the issue here is really the human story. In the Enlightenment, the idea that Europe had basically been responsible for everything positive in the entire human story, as ridiculous as that may seem to us now living in the 21st century, with the return of Chinese power, with the Indian mission to Mars, with all of these things that are going on, and it's clear how much the world is changing before us, it should be fairly obvious to anyone with half a brain that no one group of humans is responsible for everything wonderful that's ever happened, or all of scientific progress, or all philosophy. But 100 years ago, 150 years ago, that was considered a hard scientific idea, considered so normal that very few people even questioned that. And those European scholars which did question it, I can name some of them, probably no one in this room's heard of them. You ever heard of a man called Gerald Massey? He spent 36 years of his life writing a companion to Darwin's theory of evolution, working class white Englishman who taught himself to read, brilliant scholar, spent 36 years of his life writing a companion that tried to prove that not only has humanity evolved out of Africa physically, but also culturally, spiritually, philosophically. He literally wrote 6 volumes. I have them on my shelves like that. Even though he was an Englishman, the only people today that read or publish his books are crazy Afrocentric black people. So it's very funny. I'm going to continue with that. So the human story is not the monopoly of one particular group of people. And even though the ancient Greeks, this has been one of the controversial areas, a scholar called Martin Bernal from Cambridge wrote a book called Black Athena in the 80s, which received a lot of attention, a lot of criticism, a furor around the book, partly because he was a Cambridge-educated scholar, partly because of who his family were. His granddad was an Egyptologist. But nonetheless, some people might feel that he overstated the case of Egypt's influence on Greece, but the Greeks themselves said, yeah, some of us went to study in Egypt, no big deal, as you can see here. And thus, Egypt was the cradle of the mathematical arts. Can you see coming from Aristotle? That's a big compliment. There's another quote from Aristotle, I'll paraphrase, but he's basically insulting the ancient Egyptian priests, because they wouldn't give him all of their secrets. He's acknowledging they had knowledge they would not share with him. And he insults them for it, not something we look at today. They had a value for pi of 3.16, which with no calculators, thousands of years ago, is pretty impressive. I must point out that value is on a papyrus reed that we know is a child's school textbook. So we don't know whether or not they got a more accurate figure for pi, but we know that a high school student could work out pi to 2/100ths of a decimal place. The so-called Pythagorean theorem, 365-day calendar based on astronomical observation. They also had another calendar which took account of the leap year, but it didn't do it in the way we do it. It basically let the leap year run alongside. They understood that the year was 365 and a quarter days long, and they just let the quarter days add up until it came back round. I think it's 1460 years till it would come back round and the years would link up again, and they had a big festival. They understood the concept of the month and the zodiac based on groupings of stars. They pioneered heliocentric theory and the concept of the atom. Not according to Akala, but according to Isaac Newton. So if you've got beef, take up the beef with Isaac Newton. They knew of the planets Mercury, Venus, Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter, calculated and predicted lunar eclipses, medical specialization. Back then, including, if you put into your internet search, a word called Pesheshe, which is spelt exactly as it sounds, you will see that there was a government position called the Chief of Female Physicians. One of the fascinating things about ancient Egypt was the role women played in the society. I'm not going to come here and pretend to you that it was a feminist paradise, but what we do know is there were five female pharaohs, women could inherit and bequeath property, and of course, we had female physicians. Medical specialization, shipbuilding and expeditions, copious amounts of literature in poetry and prose has survived. There is three great volumes of ancient Egyptian literature published by a scholar called Mary Lichtenheim. I suggest you look them up, in addition to the coffin texts and the pyramid texts and others. Next slide, please. This is Imhotep. Has anyone seen the film The Mummy Returns? Can you see that this real Imhotep doesn't look much like the Imhotep in The Mummy Returns? And he is quite arguably the first polymath, the first multi-genius recorded in human history, the same two American physicists I mentioned earlier, Thomas Bouvard and Robert Brophy, or Robert Bouvard and Thomas Brophy, I always get their names confused. They wrote a book on Imhotep's work, but he designed the oldest pyramid still standing in Egypt, the oldest medical books in human history. He wrote, of course, someone may have wrote medical books before him, but the oldest surviving we have. So we could properly call him the father of medicine. We currently call Hippocrates the father of medicine, but Hippocrates was born 2,000 years later. Next slide, please. But I don't want to give you the impression, as some people try to, that ancient Egypt was all that happened in Africa. And even some, you know, people considered Afrocentric can overstate the case and act like ancient Egyptian civilization, impressive as it was the only civilization that occurred in Africa. It wasn't even the oldest kingdom in Africa. The oldest kingdom in Africa would be in what today that we know of, would be in what today is Sudan, a place called Kutsul. They call it the land of the bow. About 2 to 3 centuries before the rise of ancient Egypt, just as you can see, it concurs with what the ancient Greeks said about ancient Egyptian civilization coming from inner Africa, concurs with many other forms of evidence. At a place called Kutsul, there was the first kingdom, recognized kingdom in Africa, and it had many of the symbols that would later go into Pharaonic Egypt. So it was in many ways a precursor to Pharaonic Egypt. But there have been many stages of civilization in Sudan that started before and proceeded to after the fall of formal Pharaonic civilization. So if we fast forward a little bit, next slide please, and again, we see pyramids like this. I've been here. There are more pyramids surviving in Sudan than there are in Egypt, 223 in all, though they are not as old as the ones in ancient Egypt. These are of a later date. These ones are from about 100 BC. Next slide, please. Then if we go forward, there was a Christian empire in Sudan. This is a reconstruction by a Polish archaeologist of a Christian church from 1000 AD, rather. Yeah, again, pretty impressive. Based on the remains, this is what it would have looked like. Next slide, please. Fast forward to Ethiopia. Now this, I always show people this, and I usually ask, what is unusual about this building? But we haven't got time for the quiz. It usually takes people a little while to figure it out. But it's not technically a building. It's a carving. The architect and the builders of this 800-year-old church have dug down into the ground and carved the building out of the mountain. Next slide, please. And that's what it looks like inside. Can you see that's quite impressive for 800 years ago? Quite beautiful. Next slide, please. This is a stele, where it's 450 family-sized cars, the equivalent of 300 tons. We don't actually know how 2,000 years ago, people in Ethiopia managed A, to carve this block of granite, and B, to get it to stand up without a crane. And can you see, if you look closely, it's imitating a multi-story building. I can't say that they had multi-story buildings, but there's a door at the bottom, and there's what are clearly floors and the imitation of windows going up to the top. Nonetheless, it's fairly impressive to get a 300-ton block of granite to stand up without a crane. And it isn't even the largest stele found in Ethiopia in this time. The largest one found weighs 500 tons, so almost double, but it's no longer standing. Next slide, please. Now, if I showed you these castles at the beginning of this presentation, and we didn't know this was a presentation on African history, we'd probably assume these were in England or Scotland or Norway, but these are Ethiopian castles from the 17th century. Next slide, please. We get to Western Central Africa. This is the heart of where Africans were supposed to display their innate inferiority, because this is where most of the enslaved Africans enslaved in the Americas were taken from. And what do we have here? In 1668, a Dutchman called Olfert the Poor traveled around Central and Western Africa, and he drew some pictures. This is the picture from what today would be Nigeria, the Kingdom of Benin In 1668, you can see the procession of the king. You can see multi-story buildings in the background. If you look really closely, even though it's quite small for some of you in the back, you can see the city in the background. It has a wall around the outside of it. This wall, the Great Wall of Benin, is in the Guinness Book of World Records, 1974 edition, as the largest earthworks carried out prior to the mechanical era. It's estimated that the wall at its height may have been as much as 10,000 miles of walling. I didn't start or make a mistake. Go and take up the beef with the archaeologists. Next slide, please. This is the king, the city of Luango in the Kingdom of Congo. Same year, drawn by the same guy. We can see clear evidence of urban planning, straight streets, terrace housing, multi-story buildings, again, a wall around the entire outer city with gates in it. This particular state was almost like a sort of early client state of the Portuguese. For two centuries, they'd already been trading at this point ivory and pepper with the Portuguese. And this empire had an embassy in Rome during this period. Not something we learn about or talk about too tough. Next slide, please. This is the city of Agades in the Empire of Songhai, which would be in the country Niger today. This city at its height, this is again drawn by a European traveler called Dr. Henry David Bath, had 70,000 people living there in the 16th century. 20,000 to 30,000 people lived in London in the 16th century. So that gives you a sense of how quickly history can evolve. London was the largest city in the world 150 years ago in terms of population. It isn't even close to that today. So that gives you a sense of how quickly a major metropolis can become not the big metropolis anymore, and how a Western African city can have been bigger than London, and of course there not that not be the case just a few centuries later. It wasn't the largest city in Western Africa at the time. The largest empire in Western Africa, or there were four concentric empires rather, the Empire of Ghana, which was today would be in the country Mauritania, but is where the country Ghana takes its name. Then Mali, which the Empire of Mali at its height spread all the way from Senegal deep into Mauritania, 1,500 miles across, probably the most wealthy empire in African history other than ancient Egypt. And according to even mainstream scholars like Felipe Fernandez Armesto, the richest state in the 14th century world. This is one mosque slash university from that empire. This particular one is the Grand Mosque of Jenne. Has anyone ever heard of a place called Timbuktu? Now, did anyone else think Timbuktu was a made-up place when they first heard of Timbuktu? I know when I was young, I thought Timbuktu was a made-up place. Turns out Timbuktu was a real place, and there's a university still standing in Timbuktu in the ancient Malian Empire. But there's a good reason why we think of Timbuktu as being magical, as we're going to come to a little bit later. In the Malian kingdom, there are still 750,000 handwritten manuscripts surviving. 750,000 to this day, containing all kinds of information. Now, one of them was brought to the attention of the world by Michael Palin in a BBC program called Sahara. And he basically says, I'll paraphrase here, but he says this document, which is from the Kingdom of Mali at the time, clearly shows the phases of the moon. The problem with it is that it's 150 to 200 years older than the birth of Galileo and Copernicus. So it makes us think about the entire history of science in an interesting way. Again, that's not me saying that. That's Michael Palin saying that. If you've got beef, take it up with Michael Palin. Next slide, please. South and Eastern Africa. This is what they call Great Zimbabwe, one of over 100 stone courts across Southern Africa. Let's go on to the next slide. I've been here. I thought it was a bit narcissistic to include my holiday photos, so I didn't. But, no, go back, please. But this outer wall is 100,000 tons of granite bricks held together without any cement. It was built in the year 1335 AD by the Shona people of Zimbabwe. Again, I have to emphasize that most of the kingdoms I'm showing you, at some point or other, some scholar somewhere argued they were not built by Africans, and this was no exception. For a long time, people were like, could have been anyone, the Chinese, Arabs, Lebanese people, Europeans, aliens, anyone but Africans. Eventually, they gave up, and it was like, all right, yeah, the Shona probably built it. The most likely explanation is that the people that live there maybe built it. Next slide, please. This is a door. Now, can you see, if your front door looks like this today, life's all right for you. You're probably doing quite well. You're probably quite wealthy. This is a 700-year-old East African door from Zanzibar, from what we call the Swahili Confederacy. So there was a collection of city-states, almost, that spoke the language Kiswahili in East Africa, that were part of a semi-global trade network. They traded with the Middle East, with India, far afield is China, and the Javanese Empire. There's a fantastic book by a woman called Janet Abu Loghold, called Before European Hegemony, and it looks at the semi-global system of trade between East Africa, the Middle East, India, and China at the time. The wealth of this kingdom was part of the product of that semi-global trade system. Next slide, please. This is a house from the period. Now, can you see that other than the mold around the door, that could be a 1920s Art Deco house? And according to English Africanist scholar Basil Davidson, who's been there, I haven't been there, but this is what the writing here says of him investigating that, these houses, of course the houses of rich people living in this time, contain good internal sanitation. Next slide, please. This is a reconstruction of the one of the main palaces from 1300 AD in what today would be Tanzania. Can you see the swimming pool? There was 100 rooms in here. Yeah, 1300 AD palace in Eastern Africa. Next slide, please. And then we get onto the image of black people in early Europe, which is something that's contentious because we are almost taught, even if subtly, if you watch, you know, as I do for my sins, if you watch a TV show like Game of Thrones, even though you know it's not real history, it's still going in. And you watch Game of Thrones, and the only time black people pop up in this narrative that's supposed to sort of loosely be the human story, again, is as slaves. That is an accident. The casting director decided we're going to have black people, and they're going to play the slaves. And, you know, we'll get some brown people, Middle Eastern people, and they'll play Dothraki savages that eat hearts. Someone asked for that to be the case, and that's how that happened. So if you're a young person growing up, and you imagine a medieval world, you don't imagine people of African descent necessarily having participated. How do I know this? When I teach Shakespeare at schools, which I often do, and I read a passage from Othello, or I read sonnets 127 to 142, where Shakespeare clearly refers to someone who's black, but everyone's avoiding that, right? Children have actually said to me, but sir, were there black people in Shakespeare's time? And I don't realize what they're saying. People in this country, in an advanced, developed, wealthy country, because they don't realize that they don't conceive, even, of Africans having ever existed at that time in many ways. But let's see what was actually going on in Europe. So a gentleman called Saint Maurice. Saint Maurice was part of the Theban Egyptian legions of the Roman army. He became a saint in Christendom. These are carvings of Saint Maurice, or paintings of Saint Maurice, rather, from 16th century Germany. Next slide. Again, next slide. Different saint. Saint Elesban, who was said to be an ancient Ethiopian king that had fought against Jewish people on behalf of Christendom. This particular picture of him is from Portugal, from the 1750s. Next slide. This is the giant, I don't know how to pronounce that word, but I presume it's Yasur. This is from France, and this is commemorating the battle with William of Orange in the 13th century. And this is still there in the town in France where it was painted. Again, it gives us food for thought. Next slide. But this is where it gets slightly controversial and problematic. We have these images, over 100 of them, across Europe, of Madonna and Jesus depicted. Well, it speaks for itself, really, doesn't it? Now, the shame of history is this. There's a fantastic blog online called Medieval POC, which deals with the role of people of color in the medieval world. You should all follow them. They're enlightening. I've learned so much from their blog. They're on Twitter and they're on Tumblr. But one of the things they pointed out to me, I can't remember which one of these Madonnas it was, but there's one that's in Poland, a really famous one. And it was restored a couple of years ago. What do you think they did during the restoration? Yeah, they painted it white. So can you see how you can be robbed of history and not even know? Noses come off, black Madonnas go white, and no one explains why. Now, if you put into an internet search engine Isis and Horus, you might have some idea where the inspiration for this statue came from. I'll leave it at that, because that's another lecture for another day. Next slide, please. This is a European map from 1413 AD. The two gentlemen in the map, the gentleman on the left is Mansa Musa, king of the Malian Empire at its height. He is estimated by many economists today to have been the richest human that ever lived. They estimate he might have been worth as much as 400 billion in today's money. And I'm not saying that that's necessarily a massive achievement for Africa, because one person being rich and being a king sort of probably implies some form of oppression, usually. But as far as kings go, Mansa Musa was said to have been a fairly decent king who gave away a lot of money, gold, to poor people, particularly on his pilgrimage to Mecca. He gave away so much gold in Egypt that it took 10 years for the price of gold to return to normal. That's how much gold he gave away in Egypt. And part of the mythology about Timbuktu and about this wealthy black kingdom was a result of Mansa Musa's pilgrimage to Mecca and all of the rumors that spread around the world, and particularly around Europe at the time, that was going through the plague and the dark ages and all kind of other madness, while Mali was fairly rich. They were heard about this, there's this African king down there past where the Moroccans live. We need to go and find that guy because he's getting some money. Now, the gentleman on the right was the ruler of the Moors. Why have I picked this particular image? Because the way that history has been racialized, even in the modern world, for those who don't know, by the way, Spain was a Muslim country for 800 years. So African and Arab Muslims colonized Spain in 711 AD until 1492, the year Columbus set sail. For 800 years, Spain was a Muslim country. No one thinks to teach us that in school. But because there was a forms of race-based slavery in the Islamic world, some of the scholars have deliberately kind of distorted the history and said the only role of black people in the Islamic world, full stop, and even in Moorish Spain, was as servants and slaves, and that same history has come into play in that world, even though we know, because we have copious pictures, hundreds of pictures, I've just shown you St. Maurice, which also means more, of rulers, of people in every position, clearly depicted as black. One only has to read Shakespeare's Othello, and it comes very clear that Shakespeare, who Shakespeare had in mind when he was describing Moorish people. We know that there were four main dynasties in Spain, and two of the major dynasties, the Almoravid and the Almohad, were what we call Berbers. If you go to Africa today, you'll see that there are Berbers that are all kinds of mixes. The Tuareg people, for example, some of the blackest people in Africa, are Berbers, as are much of the population of Morocco. So even that history has been deliberately distorted to paint away some of the role of black African people in the Islamic world. Next slide, please. Now, this is the most contentious and controversial part of the lecture. And this is the part where I think there's some room to have some fun and for us to contemplate things that are considered outrageous. A scholar called Ivan van Sertemer wrote two books, one called They Came Before Columbus and one called Early America Revisited. And both of these books, particularly the first one, received a lot of criticism and a lot of praise. It was a very polarizing work because he suggested that Africans sailed to America before Christopher Columbus. Now, I've read a lot of the critiques of his work, and I'll be honest with you, most of the critiques I've read to this point, and I'd be happy to see a better one, have either just lied about what he said. They've said that he said all the Olmecs were Africans. He never said that. They've said that he said Africans civilized Native Americans. Who would say such a racist, idiotic thing other than a racist idiot? He never said that. He never said that Africans founded Olmec civilization. These are all things that people said he said, and even putting quotation marks in their articles, because they knew people were not going to read Van Sertemer's work. Once you labeled him a crazy Afrocentric black person, even though he's half Native American, didn't matter, job done, people are not going to read his work. Then some other critiques that I've read around his work just deal with partial pieces of the evidence in isolation and say, see, therefore he's wrong. But if you view one piece of evidence in a case in isolation, you're not building a whole case. So I'm happy to see a better, more rounded critique. But until then, I'm going to present to you some of the evidence he presents in his book. You can decide for yourself, based on the evidence in his books, if you think the position that he's put forward is rational and sensible. Not based on our bias and the ridiculous idea that Africans couldn't have sailed across the ocean, but based on actual evidence. So some of the evidence he put together, shocking as it may seem, were 13 different European witnesses, including Columbus and Columbus's son. The names are all up there. You can go and check the book, check his references, who talked about seeing Africans when they got to America. Columbus particularly doesn't talk about actually seeing them himself. He talks about the indigenous people of Haiti giving him some spears that they said they traded with black people that came from the southeast. He takes them back to Spain. They're examined by the Spanish metallurgist, who concludes they were the same as the spears they were trading with Guinea. One of these scholars here, the Frenchman, Captain Calhert, explicitly refers to the Africans he saw in Panama as Mandingos, which were the people of medieval Mali. So 13 different Europeans. African oral tradition in the Malian kingdom says that King Abubakari II left, he abdicated the throne with 200 ships to sail to the great continent to the west. There are two contemporary Arabic documents from Egypt that tell the same story of King Abubakari II abdicating the throne and sailing to the great continent to the west. None of this conclusive yet. But here's where it gets really sticky. The Smithsonian Institute found two skeletons that they concluded, based on anthropological examination, to be African tropically adapted skeletons at Hope Bay in St. Thomas, dated from 1250 AD. Gets a bit problematic. On an island just close to that, they found an ancient African writing system, which I'm about to show you, called the Tifinagh script, which originates in Libya, but was also used by medieval Malians. Modern voyages on ancient crafts. So three different European scholars rebuilt, first of all, ancient Egyptian ships, then medieval African ships, and then one guy even sailed, the last guy in that list, Alan Lombard, sailed across the Atlantic in a raft with no supplies, just a fishing rod, and he caught rainwater. So the Atlantic is not particularly hard to cross. We know that Columbus was sailing down the coast of Africa trying to get to India, and he got caught in these currents. To assume that it's impossible for an African fisherman to have made the same mistake, let alone a royal fleet of 200 ships, seems a bit strange to me. I don't know why we would assume that. And then things got even more controversial. In 1992, the female scientist who developed the test to test hair for drugs, so that test that people still use, if you're a football player, or if you're an athlete, or if you're a prison person, they want to see if you're a prisoner, and they want to see if you've been taking drugs, they examine the proteins in your hair, and they can see what kind of drugs you've been taking. The woman who developed that test in 1992 found cocaine in the stomach of Rameses II. And she was so shocked by what she found, because she knows that cocaine comes from America, she tested and retested, because she knew she was going to get loads of stick. Then she tested Sudanese mummies and found the same thing. And
Read what she said. She got hate mail, people cussing her. People were just like, what are you talking about? You're an idiot. A woman whose scientific prowess is there, you know, is there to be attested to. But what she discovered was so upsetting for some people that she was hated on by people who, of course, are nowhere near as scientifically qualified as she is. Botany and oceanography and ceremonial and cultural correspondences between some of the stuff we're seeing in Africa and in the Americas. For example, Bart Jordan, a famous mathematical genius, child genius, who was so bright that he was given a public audience with Albert Einstein when he was just a child. This is how mathematically genius the gentleman was. He'd done a study of African pyramids, of ancient Egyptian pyramids, and Mesoamerican pyramids. According to him, not according to me, I'm not on that level mathematically. According to his study, he's like, they have to have been related, because the complex mathematical relationships to particular planets like Venus that these pyramids are built around, there's just no way. He was like, it's impossible that you would get that correlation without some sort of relationship. Again, if you have an issue with it, take it up with him. I don't have the answer, but next slide. So, here we have in Mexico, in 800 BC, cane rose. No big deal. Till we turn the face round. How do we explain a face like that turning up in Mexico in 800 BC? Now, I would put it to you that if this was an overtly Chinese face, or a face that looked like a Viking, we wouldn't even have to have a debate. Everyone would be like, well, it must mean based on one face. The Vikings must have gone to America. How can you have an obviously Viking face in America unless there was Vikings there? Yet we can have a face like this, and people could honestly look at this and say, it's impossible that people of African heritage could have gone to America. Okay, and not all the Olmec heads look like that. I want to restate again, Van Certain was very clear. Not all of the Olmec heads were Africans. So pointing out that some of them don't look like Africans is irrelevant, because he was very clear that many of them are obviously not African and Native American. Next slide, please. This is the Tifinagh script that I was talking about from Hull Bay in St. Thomas. Sorry, the Tifinagh script is not in Hull Bay. It's on, does say there, Bottom Reef Bay in St. John's in the US Virgin Islands. So same collection of islands. And if you read what it says, it actually talks about ablutions. So not only is it an ancient Libyan script that we know medieval Malians used, but it makes an explicit Islamic reference. And we know that kingdom was Islamic at the time. Next slide, please. This is Mali at its height. I just wanted to show you to get a sense of just how massive it was, 1,500 miles across. And again, according to even mainstream historiography, it's now accepted that this was probably the richest state in the 14th century world. So to suggest that the richest state in the 14th century world wasn't capable of building ships and sailing the ocean seems a little odd to me. Again, I'm not saying you have to accept all of this evidence. I'm saying all I want as a counter-argument is evidence. I don't want prejudice and bias, which is what I've seen from a lot of the scholars that have counteracted Van Certain. These carvings are from Panama and Mexico, from the 1300s. The member of the German royal family called Professor von Hottenu, who helped Van Certain write the book, has over 100 of these carvings. They were tested by a process called thermoluminescence, which I don't scientifically understand, but apparently it's a way you date museum artifacts. Before the German museum would buy them, of course, they wanted to know they were not forgeries, because some people even said, he forged them all these carvings. And then they were tested before the German museum would buy them, and they were originally owned by a member of the German royal family. How do we explain carvings like this turning up in Mexico in the 1300s? And again, and again. And again, this is my favorite one. That is a handsome face, that one, let's be honest. If someone's got a more logical explanation than the people that look like this were present in Mexico, I'd love to hear it. And this is the reconstruction of an ancient Egyptian papyrus ship done by Thor Heidehau, a Norwegian, in 1969. He went to Chad. He didn't go to Egypt, he went to Chad. And the Budumu boatmen in Lake Chad rebuilt him an ancient Egyptian papyrus ship, and he sailed from Egypt to Barbados. So we know it was physically possible. So again, we've got to digest the evidence and decide what we think based on the evidence. Until then, I'm going to agree with the American head of the Smithsonian Institute that was part of the archaeological team. In fact, he was the head of the archaeological team that digged up the Olmec heads. He said the following, and I will read it word for word. He said, Van Certama's work is a summary of 6 or 7 years of meticulous research based upon archaeology, Egyptology, African history, oceanography, geology, astronomy, botany, rare Arabic and Chinese manuscripts, letters and journals of early American explorers, observations of physical anthropologists.
All right, guys, I just wanted to get a little quick session in where I'm at. I did an hour real quick, just trying to bring some highlights into his face.
Firmly convinced of the soundness of Van Certain's conclusions. But people would sell it to you. The only people who believe in Van Saitama are the Afrocentric black people trying to make themselves.
I just got
to
get some more chores done and get ready for work in the morning.
This is the final part of my...
So I streamed a little bit earlier today for a couple hours. And that's how I tell people just to be persistent, you know what I'm saying? You ain't got to get in here and bust your hump for like 15 hours at a time. Shoot. When I paint, you know, I paint for 2-3 hours here, 2-3 hours there.
There's nothing else you probably learn in school.
Sometimes just an hour at a time.
Say Africans free. I went to the National Portrait Gallery when I was a child, 7 years old. My teacher pulled me aside and pointed a picture.
Yo, really appreciate everybody hanging out with me for a little while, chilling with me, and watching me work my way through this painting right here. So, always remember, guys, follow the YouTube channel. If you're not on my social media, definitely follow me on Facebook and Instagram at Paintings by the Prince to keep up with all my new stuff. And I'll check you guys out next time, yeah. Peace.